fresh news, smart talk, all day.
The views and opinions of the hosts and guests are their own and do not necessarily reflect the position of the management and staff of Guardian Network.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be ours, it will be ours. Oh, one day, when the war is won, we will be sure.
The heavens, no man, no weapon formed against, yes, glory is destined. Everyday women and men become legends. Sins that go against our skin become blessings. The movement is a rhythm to us. Freedom is like religion to us. Justice is juxtaposition in us. Justice for all just ain't specific enough. One son died, his spirit is revisiting us. True and living, living in us. Resistance is us. That's why Rosa sat on the bus. That's why we walked through Ferguson with our hands up. When it go down, we woman and man up. They say stay down, and we stand up. Shots, we on the ground. The camera panned up. King pointed to the mountaintop, and we ran up.
One day, when the glory comes, it will be ours, it will be ours. Oh, glory, glory, glory.
Good morning. Welcome to Guardian Radio 96.9 FM. You know my voice already. It's Leyvon Miller. Thank you so much for joining me. Thank you so much for letting me join you. Other than listening to me on the radio, because they tell me I have to say this, Kermit. Other than listening to me on the radio, I don't know what else it is you're out there doing at 11 o'clock. But whatever it is that you do, I'm happy that you are doing that you have decided to do that do with me. I want to start right out of the gate by sending a special shout out to my good friend Corville Byfrom. I ran into Corville yesterday. And can I tell you that even in a COVID environment, he's doing all that he can to stay safe. But every single time I run into Corville Byfrom, it is like the Flintstones say, a yabba dabba do time. Every single time, actually. And so, yeah, Corville Byfrom, good morning. Let me also say a special shout out this morning to Mr. Clement Saunders. Clement Saunders down at Inland Revenue. I have to admit, as much as I hate having to deal with Inland Revenue for any occasion, I have to admit that Mr. Saunders down there is doing God's work. He is the consummate professional and is about all things customer service. And I mean, I've just never met somebody that goes to the lengths to ensure that they at least try to give you assistance, even when they realize that this isn't even really their area. They still try to do everything that they can to ensure that you get the kind of, service not that you deserve, because I don't know what that is they do down by the Inland Revenue, but certainly to ensure that you get the kind of service that he thinks is owing to you as a customer. All right, so we're going to talk about the news this morning. There are a whole lot of things that's going on in the news. The former prime minister, I say that tongue in cheek because I just like to call him the leader of the opposition now. I just want to let him know that you could have still been prime minister. Dun, 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 dun. He called an early election. But he said something on Sunday past that got my interest going. And he said that he called an early election because there are headwinds coming. And I, Mr. Ingram said something similar to that in the election of 2012, I think it was, which was the one that he lost. And he said that he was going to stay on as leader because there were headwinds coming. Mr. Minnis is now saying that he called an election early because there are headwinds coming. And now we're asking him to not stay on as leader. And so I just want to know, why do we continue to govern this country like a horror movie? Like, dun, 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 there are headwinds coming. As a citizen of the Commonwealth, right, that is responsible for the day-to-day running of the Commonwealth via the paying of my taxes and the upkeep of law and order, and my participation in a civilized society, I don't want politicians talking to me in folk tale. What does it mean when you say, I did this thing because there are headwinds coming? Is it, you know, like, is this like Lord of the Rings? Just tell me, as a citizen, what should I expect? Should I expect food chains to dry up? Should I expect there to be a small period of famine? Should I expect there to be a time where we need to increase taxes for an estimated window of time? What does there are headwinds coming? What you might as well had said, Peter Piper, pick a pack of pickled peppers. It has the same meaning to me. I do not know what does headwinds are coming. What does that mean? All right? And so I want to unpack that. Of course, there's also the now Deputy Prime Minister, Chester Cooper, right? He's talking about where they are with the deal with Alukaya. I want to talk a little bit about what my thoughts on Alukaya is. And why do we feel the need to be so fascinated with tourism with regards to Grand Bahama and the Alukaya deal? And maybe there's something else there to be seen. And if we could pull it off, we may do well. And then we'll get into some other things. Our minds are open. Let's talk about the news, okay? And just in case you want to know, I happened to catch about 30 seconds of the show on my way over here, and I want to say, I pull in for Michael Bindad, y'all. Please, in Jesus' name, do not make me have to put up with Crazy Thompson for the next 3 years. Please, please. If there are two things that a leader of a political party must have, those two things are, you know, accompanying integrity and morals. And I hear you all saying that he's a lawyer. But if you remember, just 5 years ago, one of the saving graces of Dr. Mendes was the fact that he wasn't a lawyer. All right? So I know when you all fall back in love with lawyers. But all I'm saying is, man, not crazy. Okay? Because leaders should have charisma and dynamism. And what is the other word? Vivaciousness. And I think crazy got none of that. All right. I don't think he could blow three candles back to back on a cake, quite honestly. That's just where I sit on it. I think he's going to be difficult to digest. I think he's not going to be able to posture well when the hits start to come about the god-awful period that they had that was the Minister administration financially. And I believe that Michael Pintard practiced something during the campaign trail. The word is called contrition. You heard Michael's heart. You heard the spirit of Michael Pintard on the campaign trail. And notice the difference while everybody else is talking about, I'm so happy to be representing the Free National Movement under the wonderful leadership of Dr. Hubert Alexander Mendes. While everybody else is running on with that silliness, Michael Pintard was the only one that I heard saying, listen, man, we know when the storm came, we didn't get there fast enough. We know that the pandemic hit. And yes, it didn't always look like we was checking for y'all. Yes, I know we put a couple of y'all in jail. Boy, and every time I think about that, my God, if I was y'all, I would stone me. But all I'm telling you is, man, we did it out of love. And I promise you, every day that we woke up, it was because we wanted to serve y'all. And I promise, while it didn't feel good, it was like a sphincter examination. It didn't feel good, but I assure you, that this digital exam is for your good. Please don't kill us and give us another chance. That was the tone I heard from Michael Pintard. While everybody else was lining up in a video to talk about how wonderful Hubert Mendes was, Michael Pintard was one of the few that I heard, and I was listening, right? That said, man, please let the FNM prove to you that we get it. And since y'all have skated them out of office, I think that the man with the contrite heart ought to lead the Free National Movement until such time as we could get the next fella in the House of Assembly, because he can't seem to get in the House of Assembly, and I don't know what's wrong with him. All right, so let me let you hear this clip from Dr. Mendes at the, I think this was at the Mount Olivet Baptist Church. If that's the same one I'm thinking about, that's the one heading into West End, up in the 8 Mile Rock area.
I think, what is the name of the pastor up there? I'll remember his name shortly. But I've visited that church before in my life. Hear what he had to say about the headwinds that are coming.
Our election defeat will not break you. We have been this road before. And we will come back even stronger.
2 months after the Free National Movement's stunning defeat at the polls, former Prime Minister Dr. Hubert Minnis sought to explain why he called the general election 8 months earlier than expected.
Many still ask the question, why was the election called? I would say to you that we have some headwinds that are coming. Those headwinds, in order to manage those headwinds that we see coming, it was essential to have a new mandate, because very, very difficult decisions has to be made.
Minnis faced criticism for calling an election in the midst of a vicious third wave of COVID-19 infections. And on election day, the party was swept out of office, holding on to just 7 seats.
We were determined to obtain that mandate so that we can make those difficult decisions and build a better country together. Your trust in the God of mercy who has brought us this far, trust that he will take us further to brighter times.
This will be one of Minnis' final addresses as FNM leader, as the party prepares to choose his replacement during its one-day convention on Saturday. Marco City MP Michael Pintard, East Grand Bahama MP Kwesi Thompson, and Central Grand Bahama MP Irem Lewis are the 3 leadership contenders. As he prepares to step down, the outgoing leader told supporters the FNM has weathered many storms which build resistance and forge character.
No one election can extinguish our hopes and our dreams for the Bahamian people. It is these hopes, dreams, and our many, many accomplishments which make the Free National Movement an extraordinary political organization. We remain the better party for the Commonwealth of the Bahamas.
Reporting for R News, I'm Vonnie Tude.
And so there you have it, right? And now I have all sorts of questions. Question number 1, what are the difficult decisions that have to be made? You're no longer the government. You could just tell us now, right? And maybe we would say, oh, Jesus, we should have let Hubert Minnis make that decision. But, you know, I don't like this whole booger man in the closet kind of government. It's not my favorite thing. Also, why couldn't you just communicate that to us? Like, you had 1 million press conferences. I tell people, Dr. Hubert Minnis was on the TV more during COVID than Winston Churchill was on the radio doing a world war. And you could have just told me what the difficult... What? Listen, we are not Neanderthals. You could just say to us, people of the Bahamas, this is your prime minister. The time has come where we need to X, Y, and Z, and I need you all to man the ship of state and stay steady behind your captain. And maybe we would have said yes. But all you do is lock us up inside the house for 17 months. What could have possibly been worse than a shuttered economy of 17 months? I don't understand it. Doesn't make sense to me. And so, yeah, no, you get to stay outside, Mr. Minnis. And I think the people, the message was clear that difficult times just isn't, I mean, that's just, what does it mean? It doesn't say anything. Let me read a text message. Text right here says, great show as usual. Could you ask the government to buy Pookie them a happy meal for not killing no one yesterday? Maybe they should. Maybe you should get free electricity if you don't murder. Good morning from Freeport. You're right. Mr. Pintard was the only one apologizing and accepting some kind of responsibility for his leader's lousy leadership. Go Pintard. This one here says, Pintard will bring a more mature level of conversation to Parliament. One problem I'm starting to have is those former MP idiots that are now backing him. Well, I mean, they are an organization, so they have to. You watch Airplane, the movie, you remember the scene when the plane was experiencing all the turbulence, and the reporter giving commentary said, famously, they knew what they were getting into. I say, let them crash. Go right ahead, F&M. Choose the winner from the three potcakes. Ground crew, get the dustbins ready. Okay, I hear you. And I don't know, maybe that's just a general consensus among people. I'm not really sure. Also happening in the news, I see former deputy prime minister, now retired politician, Theodore Brett Simonet is kind of slamming this administration with regards to his position on value-added tax. I want to say I don't particularly care for his reasoning. I don't think it makes any sense to me. And we're going to talk today, by the way, about Shane Gibson, because you're all about to make Shane Gibson a millionaire. And it played out so perfectly. They called the man name 2 weeks ago about a board, and y'all cry bloody murder. Jesus don't never let Shane Gibson eat again. Don't put him nowhere, right? Which means that the man makes a easily arguable case before the face of the court that the Free National Movement maliciously prosecuted him, consequently damaging his reputation beyond repair. And as a consequence of that, he now needs to be paid for that damage. And if he's the Shane Gibson I know, he's going to say he's Auckland's man. So he can say, man, you know how much money I could have made if you all didn't lie on me? I'm from Auckland's. You know how much money? Listen, two things Auckland's man can be: unattractive and poor. So you know how much money I was going to make if y'all didn't lie on me? I can need 20 million. I could promise you he can earn for 21 million. I promise you that's the number he can go for, right? I was going to make, I 56 now. I plan to live to be 80 because I come from a family of longevity. And I was going to make a million every one of them years for the rest of my life. So, because I don't plan to work ever again, y'all should just give me the $1 million for every single year that I stay alive. And I think that could be another 25 years. And I said, he could pick up $25 million. I say 21, the spirit just whispered in my ear, $25 million. And y'all cause it. Y'all cause it. Jesus, no, don't put him on no board. I don't want to see him around nothing. Don't let Shane touch it. That means that exactly what he is saying to the court, that Hubert Minnis, the Free National Movement, Carl Wilshire Bethel, the former Attorney General, maliciously prosecuted him. That's his argument. And that malicious prosecution has led to him not being able to hold his head up in a very small society where information is kind of, it seeps through everything, right? Like it's a permeable society. So nothing is a secret. And now I can't ever realize the full weight of my life's worth on this earth. And I want the government of the Bahamas to pay me for it. But before we go to that, let's talk about Brent Simonet. Let's go to the clip from Brent Simonet. Let's hear what Brent Simonet had to say about value-added taxes. I want to say I completely disagree with him. Albeit, I do not support the reduction of VAT to 10%. But I do not support it for Brent Simonet's reason. And I think Brent Simonet is thinking about it exactly the way rich people are thinking about it. This is exactly why I don't support the legalization of marijuana, because they think about it the way rich people think about it. I'm telling you that what Brent Simonet is going on with, poor people don't care about. Let's hear it.
Former Cabinet Minister Brent Simonet is slamming the Davis administration's decision to reduce value-added tax from 12% to 10% in the new year and to charge VAT on bread basket items.
You're taxing people on their bread basket items, people who are poor, unemployed because of Hadorian and the COVID, and now you're taxing, putting taxes on their backs? Now, I can't explain that one away, because when the F&M was the government, we took a conscious decision not to tax bread basket items, even though the experts were telling us that we should have no exemptions or no exceptions. We took a very conscientious decision not to do it.
Last month, Prime Minister Philip Davis announced that VAT reduction will take effect no later than January 1st. Simonet also weighed in on the back and forth between State Minister for Public Service Pia Glover Rolle and former Minister Brenzel Rolle over claims that public service hires continued on and after the September 16th general election.
You also look at the FNM before the election. They were confirming people who had been temporary workers for years. You've got people that are temporary workers that have been there for 30-odd years. They've gone through several administrations. I think in the last administration, the FNM tried to regularize a lot of those and make them P&P.
Simonet says this was one comment by the PLP cabinet minister that wasn't credible. He added that one of the biggest setbacks for successive governments is the 52-week program.
One of the big problems that successive governments, government had is this 52-week program where governments would hire someone. Well, if you've been hired for 52 weeks, you don't expect to be told in the 53rd week to go home. I mean, you know, we got to be real about that. So you're expecting to be hired. So if you regularize that, then there's a real reason for doing that. So I think you're seeing some of the early comments by ministers that may not have credibility when they do the test of time.
Reliable.
And so the whole, we were very deliberate about not putting value added tax on bread basket items. I want to tell you, Brent Simonet, for those of us that are poor and actually go to the food store, we don't even know. We don't know what all the VAT on, quite honestly. When we go and push our trolley to the cashier lady, no, all the grocery just adds up as grocery. And the average one of us don't even ever go through that bill to see, oh, well, did they put the VAT on the corned beef? So I do believe, right, like when you go to license your car or when you get your money from the ATM or when you do any one of these ridiculous services with the bank that they want to charge you 12% on and you see the 2% saved there, you may actually say, eh, well, I saved 2%, whether that matters to you or not. But I don't really know if people are just going to die because 10% VAT is put on the corned beef. I don't see that as being reasonable. I still don't agree with VAT reducing to 10%. The Prime Minister has given a hard date. It'll happen by January 1. Jesus. Right? So let's see. I mean, they have the corn. They know the numbers. Michael Halkidis is apparently one of the smartest people on the planet. He obviously knows what is necessary to get it done. He has an FS that I believe he's comfortable working with and trusts, right? And let's see how it all turns out. Okay, the phone lines are open. 323-623-2354-316-325-4259. This text right here says, good morning, Leyvon. That speech is garbage. If they are the best party, why didn't they do better? I don't know. Good morning, sir. Thank God. Good morning, sir. Thank God. Minus gone. Thank you, Lord. Amen. My goodness. I visited that church in Freeport before in my life. Whose other life would I have visited in? I don't know. I'm just saying, in my life's time, I have visited that church before. Is that inappropriate language? In my life's time, I've visited that church before. I'm not saying that I visited it in somebody else's life. There's nothing wrong with that sentence. She ain't gonna get 21 million if the man who get his teeth knocked out by the police only get 100,000. Well, first of all, the man who get his teeth knocked out ain't Shane Gibson, first of all. And I'm telling you, Shane is an Auckland's man. He can say, boy, you know how much money I was gonna make if y'all didn't fool with this? Let's read it. The story is in Tuesday's National Guardian, November 23rd. And it says, former cabinet minister D. Shane Gibson said he suffered a substantial blow to his reputation and his finances after he was brought on corruption charges in 2017 as a result of the malicious political shenanigans of the Minnis administration. In an affidavit in support of his application for cost after he was found not guilty on 15 counts of bribery in the Supreme Court 2 years ago, Gibson maintained that he is in fact innocent of the charges and pointed out that the evidence relied on by the Crown during the course of the matter was insufficient to support a reasonable expectation of a conviction by a fair and impartial jury. Yesterday, Gibson scored another legal victory when Acting Chief Justice Bernard Turner awarded him costs. The former minister had sought costs under Section 20 of the Provision of Bribery Act, which permits a person acquitted after trial before the Supreme Court to make such an application. The Act says a court may award costs to that person and that costs are to be taxed and paid out of the consolidated fund. In his application filed late last year, Gibson said, I am unemployed. Story goes over to page A6. I do not have a regular source of income except for my pension. Due to the notoriety surrounding my trial and the nature of the charges against me and the widespread media coverage highlighting the developments in the saga from investigation to the conclusion of the trial, I am limited in my options to find substantial employment. My acquittal hearing has not mitigated the adverse economic impact and loss of opportunities that I now face. Gibson added, the public interest in my trial was widespread and the Crown employed weighty levers of state to ensure that resources were not spared to facilitate my prosecution. The former minister's arrest charge on August 2nd, 2017 came months after the Progressive Liberal Party was swept out of office amid claims of corruption in May 2017. Gibson was alleged to have received more than $250,000 from contractor Jonathan Ash in exchange for him using his authority as a responsible minister to facilitate the release of around $1 million in payments the government owed Ash for cleanup work after Hurricane Matthew in October 2016. The former minister was tried in the Supreme Court and was acquitted on November 27, 2019. In an affidavit supporting his application for costs, Gibson said, I have substantial legal bills that relate directly to my defense in the subject proceedings. These fees were incurred and warranted because I had to employ a team of senior counsel to match the Crown prosecutor who was brought in on special call from the United Kingdom to lead the Crown team of prosecutors. And man, and you know, Carl Bettle was the Attorney General. I don't know how Carl Bettle. I just don't know. I don't know. Anyway, where was I in this? The trial and the other interlocutory hearings in this matter were lengthy and led to the accrual of substantial legal fees for preparatory and trial work on my behalf. Gibson said he would have to deplete his remaining investments, including his retirement funds, and rely on the possible assistance of others to meet his obligations where he made to pay costs. He concluded that he should not be penalized or face the severe financial impact that will flow as a consequence of the Crown's failed prosecution. Gibson was represented by Damian Gomez, QC, and attorney Owen Wells of McKinney Turner & Co. Anthony McKinney, QC, the firm's senior partner, noted yesterday that costs need to be assessed, but pointed out it will likely be pocket change that must be paid out given the amount of work involved in this case. The assessed costs will come after both sides present the relevant claims in relation to the case, including legal hours spent on the matter and how many lawyers are involved. I'm not going to speculate on the amount, but I'm saying it wasn't a common or garden case. So it's something that will require a lot of effort and energy in formulating what costs should be, McKinney told the Nassau Guardian. I like to tell you what I hear when I read these things. Mister, you see they bring a whole QC out here, and I ain't just a QC. I is QC and managing partner of the firm. If you believe I coming out here to work for regular counsel pay, this how I know something wrong with your head. I can't tell you what this could cost, because I ain't sure if I got no calculator what could add this up. So you know what I got to do? Now I have to go hire me a team of mathematicians to calculate what exactly am I valued in a case like this, and then what Damien value in a case like this, because Damien was there too. And he is a QC, and I is a QC. And in no way, you're going to have one bunch of QC running up and down around here and believe that can cost no couple of dollars. I tell you all, don't let this crazy boy prosecute this man. Y'all ain't listen. Then y'all go and call the boy from where he's from, London. Y'all had all kind of money. So since y'all got all this money, I coming back to tell y'all what it could cost y'all for causing me. That's basically what he said, yeah. Let's continue. Ask what message he thinks this kind of ruling on cost sends to the Crown. McKinney responded, in every case where a person's liberty and reputation and general standing in the community is impacted, the Crown has to be very careful when it decides to prosecute anyone. But when a case of this nature is going to be pursued, the Crown ought to be extremely careful because they know there are consequences, not just in terms of money, but you do a lot of damage to people, especially when you don't have sufficient evidence to support whatever allegation you are making. Winning the case is one thing, McKinney added, but repairing the damage done is almost impossible to do. McKinney also filed an affidavit in the matter involving costs. He said the circumstances of the investigation and trial of Gibson were fraught, at minimum, with a questionable rationale by the Crown in its continuing efforts to pursue a conviction. The FNM, through its political aspirants, led by Dr. Hubert Minnis, had continually pushed in its public utterances the party's political mantra that the PLPs were guilty of substantial corruption and misfeasance in office and pledged to prosecute those PLP members upon the FNM's election to office, McKinney stated in the affidavit. The applicant, Gibson, has been an erstwhile target of his political antagonists from 2002 to present. He has been on the receiving end of direct accusation, innuendos, and hints in the public domain that he was dishonest in the execution of his public office. A pattern was established when he was investigated, calling for question repeatedly and harassed during 2007 and thereafter following the FNM assuming the government in 2007. McKinney noted that the now former Minister of National Security, Marvin Dames, had pledged there would be no political interference in such investigations by the FNM government. Gibson is convinced that his prosecution was initiated solely in fulfillment of the FNM's political mantra to go after and prosecute certain members of the PLP, notwithstanding that such prosecutions would not be warranted under ordinary circumstances and could not survive unbiased scrutiny, he added. McKinney said in his affidavit that Gibson behaved in an exemplary manner throughout his trial and did not obstruct or otherwise impair the proceedings. In contrast, he said, evidence of police and prosecutorial misconduct marred or otherwise complicated the trial process and necessitated the employment of numerous counsel to ensure that Gibson's interests were adequately protected. In a separate matter, Gibson last year sued the government, alleging malicious prosecution and false imprisonment. Gibson's attorneys filed a suit against the Attorney General, the Commissioner of Police, the Director of Public Prosecution, Assistant Superintendent of Police Deborah Thompson, and Ash, the contractor. Gibson is seeking damages for false imprisonment, damages for malicious prosecution arising out of multiple charges of extortion, bribery, misconduct in public office, laid maliciously and without reasonable or probable cause, aggravated damages, exemplary damages, interest pursuant to Section 3 of the Civil Procedure Award of Interest Act 1982, costs and further relief. That matter remains outstanding. Two other former PLP parliamentarians were also brought on corruption charges after the FNM was elected in 2017. Former Public Hospital Authority Chairman Frank Smith was acquitted in February 2019. The case of former Environmental Minister Kenrod Dorsett has not yet been heard, more than 4 years after he was charged. Speaking in the Senate earlier this month, Attorney General Ryan Pinder said the Minnis administration spent $807,755.87 in foreign lawyers on the prosecution of Gibson and $290,903.44 on the prosecution of Smith. Y'all go Shane Gibson one truckload of money by the time as this is all over. I might as well tell y'all that right now. Because this McKinney QC fella, he ain't come to play. And I even hear from Damien yet, but I assume Damien ain't come to play. And Shane say, all I have is pension. You can't want me to pay these bunch of lawyers out of this. So y'all gonna need to give me some money. And y'all spend how much this was? $807,755.87. Whoop. What y'all spend the 87 cents on? That was the paperclip say. What in the lawyer fee was 87 cents? That was the binary, what you call those things? The binary ties? And then y'all turn around and y'all spend another $209,903.44. Y'all had all kind of money. So I don't care who pay me. Ash, Deborah, Gaskins, I don't care. I don't care if the money fall like manna from heaven. Pay me. And all of this was for how much? $250,000? Well, I can need $1 million for every one of them numbers in there. Like 250,000. Let's times that by, my math sucks. So I think it's times it by 10,000. How you get to 25 million from there? You do the math and let me know. Anyway, I got a phone call. Let's take this phone call and then I go to break. Good morning, caller. You're on. Caller, you there?
Good morning. How you doing?
I'm well.
Good morning.
Hi, how are you?
I'm okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. I heard even that Frank Smith. Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Yeah. He was saying how his reputation was internationally.
Mm-hmm.
You know, but he's an accountant.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I wonder when he's coming forward.
Oh, I believe he could be next. What I think he won't do, because, you know, he is an accountant, right?
Right.
And Shane Gibson is a trade unionist.
Then he has won his case.
Right. So I believe what he could do is he could watch Shane.
Uh-huh. That sort of damaged his reputation, too.
Mm-hmm. I agree with you.
You said, I believe he's going to be next, too.
No, absolutely. Listen, as sure as water is wet, you could guarantee the minute they pay Shane, they have to pay Frank next. What I believe Frank is going to do is he's going to sit there because, you know, Shane is a trade unionist. They don't make as much money as accountants.
Right.
So when they pay Shane, he can say, well, Jesus, if you're going to give Shane 25, mm-hmm. he even ain't no accountant. Mm-hmm. I must he could give me 35. Mm-hmm. And that's what's going to happen because the only thing an accountant has is honesty and his reputation.
Exactly.
An accountant don't have, if an accountant is found to be a liar, he can't ever work again.
Exactly.
Or
a
thief.
And I was more than surprised of the, see, I could say, you can't.
Mm-hmm. mm-hmm.
The Guardian.
Mm-hmm.
When they heard that he was appointed, you know, deputy or being, you know, they came out, put controversy before his name and sort of stretched it and just exactly what the FNM had counted out to be.
Mm-hmm.
That's exactly how the Guardian played in the FNM hand.
Mm.
Yes.
Well, I do know one thing. Shane Gibson has a very easily arguable case. And the reason I make that position is because if you recall 2 weeks ago it was aired out that he was being considered as a deputy chair.
That's
of
what I mean.
The,
and then the Guardian
man and they wanted to kill him.
Big that up, especially the Guardian lead debate. I see how you could say it, you can't say it.
The people wanted
the
to
Guardian
kill him.
The Guardian led debate
mm-hmm.
and put some controversy before his name, you know, to stop and fall right in the hands of the FNM what they wanted to do
mm-hmm.
to study his name.
But that definitely is going to work to his benefit, you know, because I mean, I hear people say, I don't want to see Shane Gibson run, nothing.
Right, you see?
The fact that you feel
point.
That way means that what he is saying has been done, and because of that, you should pay him.
Mm-hmm. And I try to figure out why the Guardian mm-hmm. never put those controversy names like with Brent Simonet.
I know.
Then he was
I'm
appointed
sure.
this and appointed minister and appointed that.
Uh-huh.
Why choose Shane Gibson?
Well, you know, Hubert Ingham has said before that the way we do our politics in the Bahamas is your punishment is being booted out of office. That is your punishment. And so I guess Hubert Minnis wanted to come and set a different tone that being booted out of office wasn't enough and he wanted to practice prosecution. But when you listen to that case, and this is why I tell you all, I know which law school the last attorney general been to, but I don't know an ounce of law. But listening to this case, I kept thinking to myself, why are they not nollying this? But you know why? It's because they had already made such a public spectacle about the nolly process, right? That they couldn't use sound legal reasoning and just nolly the thing and make it go away and pay the fella quietly and end it all. No, y'all drag the man to court on crutches and then make him come, him and his wife to court every day. Yeah, y'all pay Shane Gibson, man. That's all I want to say. I see the phone lines are lighting up. 323-623-2254-316-325-4259. I'm taking a break. When I get back, I take the phone calls. Leyvon Miller, it's Guardian Radio. We'll be back right after this.
At Fidelity, the holidays are all about family, spending time with loved ones, and being thankful for the little things in life. Worrying about bills should be the last thing on your mind, especially during the holidays. Let Fidelity help you get your bills under control. Fidelity can also get you started with a real savings plan that actually pays you interest. the only thing you need to think about is what you will do with the savings in your pocket this Christmas. Now that's what I'm talking about. Fidelity Bank is here for you this holiday season because you are family, and family is important to us.
COVID-19 doesn't take holidays off, and neither should you. We can celebrate the holiday season while continuing to follow all public health protocols and regulations. We must also remember to wash our hands and sanitize frequently. Wear our masks, cough and sneeze into our elbows, disinfect items brought into our homes, stay at least 3 feet away from others in public, and remain at home when we're feeling unwell. Let's have a happy and healthy holiday.
This message brought to you by Bahamas Ministry of Health, in conjunction with Guardian Radio.
Food security is a challenge for many. Now in a pandemic, many more are unsure of their next meal. Through their Feed 5000 program and a $20,000 donation, AML is working to ensure that everyone has a meal for the holidays, and they're inviting you to help. Now until December 17th, visit any Solomon's, Costrite, Fresh Market, or Domino's in Nassau or Freeport, and Exuma Markets in Georgetown to donate and help feed a family in need this Christmas. No amount is too small. Remember, we're all in this together.
This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, Nassau, Bahamas.
Welcome back. Thank you for staying with me. It's Leyvon Miller. It's Guardian Radio. That means I'm unleashed on your radio. That means it's somewhere between 11 and 12 o'clock. The phone lines are open. 323-623-2325-4316-325-4259. I think I got everything out of my head that I want to say about Shane Gibson. All I want to say, oh yeah, I forget one other thing. Shane, you from Acklands. I from Acklands. We's Acklands boys together. You out of Pine Field. I from Snow Corner. If you need somebody to help you tote the money around, I always did one tote money around in my life, right? And it's these Acklands boys, the two of us, you know what I mean? These homeboys, right? So when they pay you, right, like you may need somebody to drive you. I drive really well. You know, I'm also trained in a small arm carry. So that means, because we can need a gun, that's plenty of money. And you can need a fella that can keep up. I kind of a little slower these days. I don't run as well anymore, you know. I kind of fat now. But I still shoot very well. And I just want to say that, you know, if you looking for somebody that from Acklands, you know, these homeboys, okay? And I pull in for you. You think that could work? 323-623-2325-4316-32. Guy from Acklands. And the two of us is straight to God. She and you straight to God, and I straight to God. I feel like this is a match made in heaven. Let's take this call. Good morning, caller. You're on. Call you there. Good morning, caller. You're on. Not there. Next one. Good morning, caller. You're on.
Hey, pleasant. Good morning, Leyvon. How you doing?
Hey, Antoine.
Good morning to the nation as well. Just wanted to say, as it relates to the Shane Gibson matter,
mm-hmm,
and Frank Smith, mm-hmm, I trust that the attorneys will pursue through the courts to the end of earth for them to be fully restored. Because, as Mr. Gibson stated, it's not an easy road,
mm-hmm,
and the government was malicious in their pursuit, even though they did not have a case, even though they did not present or have adequate evidence to, mm-hmm, pursue him or to pursue Frank Smith. They still brought them to court and created great damage personally to them and to their families. As a result, it's a pity, and it's most unfortunate that the behemoth taxpayer will have to bear the burden. And I would hope that the Davis-led government, Prime Minister Davis, will put in law, if there is some negligent pursuit of justice by any person in the employ of government against any other person under negligent terms, that individual or those individuals could also be held fully accountable along with the government for repaying whatever the courts deem fair in their assessment. Thank you for the opportunity.
Appreciate it, Anton. Let's take another one. Good morning, caller. You're on. Caller, I can hear you breathing. Hello.
Hello.
Hey, what's up?
How you doing?
I'm good.
Let me ask you something. Do you think the case with O.J. Simpson, you think O.J. did that term with those people?
No, I don't think O.J. do it.
You don't don't think OJ do that.
Mm-mm. I think if the court say OJ ain't do it, then he ain't do it.
Okay. So that's mean everything what the court say, we believe.
Yes, and I'll tell you why. It's because I, Leyvon Miller, do not want to make it a practice living in a society where I believe that the court's view or vision can be so jaded that the court cannot clearly and impartially delineate right from wrong and deliver a judgment, right? I want to live in an ordered society. What does that mean? It means that there will be time that the court will rule things that I don't necessarily like. But I believe that the system is such that if we are going to have fair and balanced court cases, because when they lie on me and drag me to court, I want people to say, well, that's they put him in court without no trial, that's good for him. Right? No, I don't want to live in that kind of society. So if the court...
I want to ask you one more question.
Uh-huh.
And then I'll probably hang
sure.
up because I know you're running short on time.
Sure.
Did you believe the gentleman who killed the two people and injured the next one, did that?
Which case is this?
Come on, I assume that you in the media, you should...
I listen to 100 court cases every year. Give me more. The gentleman that killed which two people?
He killed two people, injured one.
Mm-hmm. You need... Which case? Is in the Bahamas you're talking about? Is he gone? I don't know. You need to give me more details than that. The man who killed the two people and injured one... I listened to a million court cases. Give me more specifics. Good morning, caller. You're on.
Hey, Mr. Rowe. Hey, Mr. Miller. What's up, brother?
All is well, do it.
Man, these FMs, they still calling your talk to trying to find out something.
I know. They all lose. I saying to them, do it.
Old man, you're lose, sir. Get a life. You're lose. But, Mr. Miller, you know something? The only person that's suffering this whole thing
is the Bahamian people.
It's us.
It's the taxpayer, yes.
Who got to pay the money?
No, but and I hear that. But, do it. If you're a lie on Joyce Boy, I telling you, nah. I want $2 million for every year that I can live for the rest of my life because I ain't waking no more for the rest of my life.
I mean, the parade with Mr. Gibson in particular, right?
Mm-hmm.
How they had him in his chain, handcuffed, shackled, like, and then he just came out of a boat accident knowing that the man was not, in particular, his legs was in as well.
Mm-hmm.
But they still decided to make a public parade on him now. The shoe on the other foot.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to figure out is that, like, I think the lady, I want to piggyback off something the lady said.
Mm-hmm.
Why isn't the news media now, newspapers talking about Mr. Gibson as they did when he was going to be appointed as the deputy chairman of BTC?
I don't know.
You
but
hear
I,
him now.
I never took the position. I never took a position that he shouldn't be made deputy chair. I heard the whole argument about damage to political collateral, blah, blah, blah. I want to live in a society where if the court sends me to jail, I accept that
That's
fate
right.
because I know the court is impartial. I also want to live in a society where if the court vindicates me...
That you can live a normal life.
Precisely. And I think that's reasonable and fair.
And it's only... And before I hang up, Mr. Miller, let me say this to every person in this country.
Mm-hmm.
Every man is considered, whether you're rich, poor, middle class, upper class, whoever, you're considered to be innocent until proven guilty. And the fact remains, if the court acquit Mr. Miller or the jury acquit Mr. Miller, there is nothing else nobody else can say. I mean, you could say, or you could have your conspiracy theory,
keep
but at the end
head.
Of the day, you are free. Your life goes on.
Yeah. No, I appreciate it. And as a matter of fact, let me add to that. A man ought to be draped. He ought to bathe in his innocence until such time as you could prove otherwise. A man doesn't have to prove innocence. This text right here says, Miller, where are you going to get a small carry permit from? Man, yeah, it ain't got it. This Shane Gibson, we talking about, you know. You don't think Shane could tell the people, look, I Shane, you know. I need one gun, and Miller can need one gun. Give Miller the automatic one, because we need him to do most of the shooting. And, you know, yeah, man, we can get a gun, that ain't no problem. And I am an advocate of gun carry, so we're both British colonies. That makes us different. This one here says, Miller, I feel the whole prosecution of Shane and Frank is a ploy. It was a setup for exactly what we are seeing. They can't send them to jail. They'll snitch. I don't know, I guess. I hear you. Good day, Leyvon. I listened to your commentary, but what you and the listening audience fail to realize is that Carl Bettle is costing us, the taxpayers, this financial burden. So, Leyvon, don't be proud of this debacle. I tell you a long time, take Carl Bettle from around anything that had to do with the law. Y'all ain't listen to me. Y'all make him QC and all, and Attorney General. I don't know what he was doing in there. I don't know. And you know what is even more, I mean, bewildering? Carl Bettle been to school with me and Motley. He couldn't have gone to the same class then. That's impossible. It's not possible. How does a school that produced Mia Motley also produce Carl Bettle? I can't figure that out. You had to believe alive to visit it. It's during my lifetime. Okay, sure, no problem. Okay, I guess. Notwithstanding the crown and what they didn't find, Mr. Gibson has built $2 million homes. Okay, I guess. Miller, tell DeWitt, please give the FNM a break, sir. DeWitt, give the FNM a break, sir. Leyvon, from day one, the FNM said urban renewal is foolishness, yet every time they win, they stock it up with their people. When they lose, no one wants to go home. Miller, you see why the former FNM government need a commission of inquiry? CM, everyone who sued them and the lousy AG Attorney General Carl Bettle, who lost most of his cases, won a fortune and big money. So PM Davis would be wise to be fully honest and transparent of the former government and going forward. And the government of the Bahamas, what does it say, with sense and decency and order, because karma is inevitable. You reap what you sow. Let me see if I can get one more in. This one here says, so what the defense, how he get to $25 million, his salary as an MP or board member would not exceed $100,000, and he ain't the only politician who sits unemployed for 5 years when their party out of office. This is a common cry. So what the defense needs to do is roll out all the politicians whose finances plummeted when their party was out of power. But you can't tell me what the value of my life would have been. How you know I wasn't going to get called up to be a consultant for a Fortune 500 company? Listen, don't be too eager to pay out costs. It's coming from our pockets. Man, y'all pay the man. Good morning, Leyvon. Excellent show again. Mr. Gibson clearly has no shame in his game. He's reluctant not to be jailed at this time. No one would want to go to Fox Hill Prison. Great show as usual. I think the former PM Minister would make an amazingly great job at running the Fox Hill Prison, because no matter what the prisoners do, their punishment would be prison lockdown. Okay, that's my time. That's the show. I'm Leyvon Miller. I didn't get to Lucaya. I really want to talk about Lucaya. Maybe tomorrow. Anyway, I'm Leyvon Miller. This is Guardian Radio 96.9 FM, the station for fresh news and smart talk. Don't move. The news, it happens now.